Good morning.
Good morning.
I know everyone else has already been ready already, and now I am ready too. Technology is my friend. Technology is my friend. If I keep saying it, then hopefully one day it'll be true. But it's great to see everyone. Everybody looks so cool out there. You know, just totally chill, and just if you get warm, then. Head outside for about a half a second and waddle your way back in frozen and everything will be fine. But glad we were all able to make it out this morning and across the frozen tundra to make it to worship. And of course, as a reminder, we have opportunities to be able to come together. We have Bible classes 9:30 on Sunday mornings and Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. And then of course, worship service now. It is great to be able to get together with our family, and also got some visitors with us. And so great to have everybody here this morning. And if you want to look at things later, of course, we do record the worship services, and we have on our Facebook page the link to the YouTube video of the worship service so that we can go back and hear that song one more time, just in case Jeremy wants to sing it one more time. He just go right back and find it. But also a great opportunity to be able to share with others. If it's a particular topic in a sermon that you want to, hey, listen to this, then you got it there that you can send a link. Also have our website has an easy button there for getting to our Facebook page and YouTube page so that you can point them out. And there's also a lot of other good stuff on the website. There's some articles by our prolific author, Professor Bob, I guess is Sid calls him. But we got some articles written that we've had. Some have been in the house-to-house, heart-to-heart. Some have just been written in the papers that we've had. But got a lot of good articles there. And then also links to other websites that we can go to be able to study more. So lots of opportunities for us to study, lots of opportunities for us to be able to share with others so we can help them study and see the truth. As a reminder, we have a great responsibility and also an awesome ability to be able to pray to God. And He wants us to talk to Him all the time. And so we have an encouragement over and over again to be a prayerful people, to pray without ceasing, praying for our leaders, and again, whether that's the world leaders that we have all the way down to leaders of the congregation here and local leaders in government, leaders of families. Pray for our leaders that they will be able to search the scriptures and use God's word as guidance. And there's, again, we have our family around the world that are being persecuted just because they're Christians. And keep them in your prayers that they will be able to maintain their faith and be able to make it through some of the hard times that we have. Of course, a family that's in Ukraine, in the Middle East, that are constantly under attack, again, just for being a Christian. But they also are striving to live a life that is pleasing to God. And so continue to remember them. Also, those that we support or have supported in the past, to those in Costa Rica, in India and Kenya. And then locally, I have a list here, and there's some other information available in the bulletin if you get a chance to get that. And of course, remembering Tyndall being over in Poland, and of course, and then remembering Sean because Tyndall's over in Poland for a year. But definitely continue to remember them. April's having ultrasound on her side for some pain in February, and of course remember Roy and Wanda. Of course, as we know, Cheryl Isaacs passed away Friday. The funeral is tomorrow night in Tocoa, and so remember that family as they are going through that. We have Eric Griswold on the list again. He had some surgery, and they found more cancer, and so they've recommended chemo. I think they're working on the game plan on getting that done, but he has already gone through a good bit, so definitely keep him in your prayers. I added Seth Potts up there, a new name. He's the son of Scott and Rhonda Sailors, for those of you that know him or know them from Harmony Grove. He's 38. He's got congestive heart failure. He's in the hospital right now. you know, wife, a couple of little kids, and just he's had ongoing issues with that, but it's gotten worse recently, so they're trying to figure out what more they can do to help him. So definitely keep the Potts family in your prayer. And then Kathy Scott has got some surgery lined up for January the 23rd. And so keep her and Russell in your prayers as she is to continue to fight the cancer that she has. And there's a lot more information that's in the bulletin, and I may have missed something. I apologize if I did. But normally at this time, we spend some time in prayer together, but some silent time. And so we'll just, again, have this time for the next couple minutes. Let's pray together quietly. And I will leave the names up here on the screen so that we can read over them. And then following this time, then Steve's going to lead us in prayer together.
Our loving and all-righteous Heavenly Father, holy and reverend is your name. Father, we come before you this morning as your children, seeking your guidance, your wisdom, your comfort, your healing. The world is full of turmoil, and we realize from our own experience and from your word, that in Christ we have peace. We have peace with you, and the peace that surpasses all understanding. We thank you for this gift, and we thank you for the privilege of prayer, and that we can come before you, expressing to you our greatest desires, our innermost feelings, that are difficult to put in words. Among us, Father, are people who are hurting. There are those who are suffering from physical ailments, from the cold, but there are those who are struggling emotionally. We pray for comfort for us, for all of us, your children. We know among us are people who are struggling physically with illnesses, disease. And we pray for those, for their comfort, for their healing in ways that only you can provide. And we know that there are those who are spiritually sick, who are weak, find it difficult to keep your will first in their lives. We pray for them and for all of us that we might have your blessings for forgiveness, and help us to remember to realize these shortcomings in our lives, and that we might turn to you for forgiveness, for healing, and for the help that we need in this life. We thank you for your Son that has provided all these things according to your will and made it possible for us to be redeemed, made it possible for us to come before you as your children. Thank you for all your great gifts. Thank you for your love for us. May we always keep your will first in our lives, that we might serve you best, not only in this time, but forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may have noticed in the bulletin the title of Gary's lesson this morning is on the first slide, "Now I Lay Me Down to Sleep." So stay tuned. It'll be a very good lesson. I don't think any exception. In our singing this morning, in the words that we'll be reading from God's Word, realizing and remembering truly the relationship that we have with God, the comfort that we can have, the promises of His that we can rely upon. Jesus told His disciples before He was crucified, He said, "You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery." Truly we have great blessings through our Savior, and we honor him from our hearts as we sing the words of these songs, remembering how truly Jesus understands and cares for us. I would love to tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so strong and true. I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. Does Jesus care when my heart is pained too deeply for mirth and song? As the burdens press and the cares distress, and the way grows weary and long. Oh yes, he cares, I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. When the days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. He taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand.
We just finished up our holiday season, as it were, where a lot of people are tend to be a little bit more generous than they normally are, and we want to take food to the homeless, and you know, there's a lot of different groups and organizations that want to help those that are in need. And that, you know, that time of year in December and in Thanksgiving, you know, everybody wants to help those that are less fortunate. And even here in the church, you know, we want to try to reach out and help those in the community. And a long time ago, that kind of got me in trouble, because sometimes the words come out of my mouth or in my head that just stay in my head. But you know, those people are hungry all year. Not just in December and the holiday season. And you know, the Bible tells us that we're supposed to lay by and store so that when the need arises, it's there. And there are people that are in need. There are people in this community, in this congregation that are in need of help, not just financially, but spiritually and physically. And we're supposed to be there as Christians year-round, every day, to be able to reach out and meet those needs. And we have the opportunity on the first day of the week today, this time, to be able to take a portion of the blessings that God's given us and to set those aside so that when those that come to the congregation, come to the church, have a need, that we're able to help with that need. So let us give thanks for the things that God has given us.
Most kind of gracious Heavenly Father, come this morning, first day of the week, with joy, to be able to worship you, and at this time, to thank you for all the blessings that we have, and all that we have that we can share a part of it. We thank you for this congregation. We thank you for this leadership, yes, to bless this leadership, that we can put these funds in the right way, for the way that you would want us to do. Heavenly Father, we pray for those that are unfortunate, and we take this time to remember that it may be just part of our funds of what we have, but what you really want is everything that we have, that deep down in our souls. And this, Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people. training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. May we always strive to live our lives in ways that follow that teaching, that instruction, that we live our lives for Jesus.
Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please him in all that I do, yielding allegiance, glad-hearted and free. This is the pathway of blessing for me. Living for Jesus, who died in my place, bearing on Calvary my sin and disgrace. Such love constrains me to answer his call, follow his leading and give him my all. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee, for thou in thy atonement didst give thyself for me. I own no other master, my heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone. Living for Jesus, wherever I am, doing each duty in his holy name, willing to suffer affliction and loss, deeming each trial a part of my cross. Living for Jesus through earth's little while, my dearest treasure, the light of his smile. Seeking the lost ones, he died to redeem, bringing the weary to find rest in him. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee, for thou in thy atonement didst give thyself for me. I own no other master, my heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone.
Let's pray together.
Father in heaven, we are so thankful to you for this opportunity.
condition before you, and in some cases, as this song that we were just singing, that we were making promise that we would live according to your way. We pray that you give us the strength to be able to do that every day. We're aware of some who are sick, and pray that you be with them. Some have been mentioned, and some that we just know about. Help each one of them as he has individual need. We're also aware of the fact that there are many Christians throughout the world who are suffering hardship because of persecution. And we pray that you be with them, help them to endure, help them to have the strength and have the faith to stand up for you and no matter what comes to them. And we pray that you would help us also to gain that same kind of faith that would help us to overcome if we were to be faced with the same thing. We pray that you be with those who are not with us today because of various reasons. We know that the same, but we also know that there are others that could not be with us because of the same failings that they have. Help all of us, though we might be living with a pain each day, and though we might be very often even more serious, we pray that you'd help us to be able to endure. This morning, as we're saying here this morning, we want to be able to express to you how we actually feel. And we know that this is so many times impossible because we really don't know how to pray as we ought to, and we pray for your understanding and your guidance. Help us now as we continue in this worship period that our remembrance of Jesus' suffering as we'll be doing together in a few minutes. That during that time, each one of us will be drawn closer to you, drawn closer to Jesus, and drawn closer to each other. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Before Jesus was crucified and he was meeting with his disciples and telling them many things that he wanted them to remember, especially after his death. And he said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to where I'm going." And Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The words of this song remind us of these facts that Jesus told his disciples, and even how these words have meaning to us individually.
Thou art the way to thee alone. From sin and death we flee, and he who would the Father seek. Must seek him, Lord, by thee. Thou art the truth, thy word alone. True wisdom can impart. Thou only canst instruct the mind and purify the heart. Thou art the life, the rending tomb, proclaims thy conquering arm. And those who put their trust in thee, nor death nor hell shall harm.
Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree. So that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith. As we think about these words and the words of this song, we're reminded of the fact that through Christ we've been redeemed. And it is only through Christ that such a gift is possible. And after we sing this song, we'll partake the Lord's Supper together.
By Christ redeemed, in Christ restored, we keep the memory adored, and show the death of our dear Lord until he body given in our stead, is seen in this memorial bread. And so our feeble love is fed until he fearful, unknown agony, his life blood shed for us we see. The wine shall tell the mystery until he thus that dark betrayal night, with the last advent we unite, by one bright chain of loving right, until he
gathered here this morning, I'd like for us to think about a few things as we before we pass the plate and the cup around. Says in the front of this table here that as often as you do this in remembrance of me. That's the command that Jesus gave Paul as he was giving the instructions on how we're to partake of this. But Paul also told us in Romans that we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. We know that we partake of this bread, which represents the body of Christ, the flesh, the person, the human Christ that walked on this earth. And we know that we take this cup, which represents the blood that was shed on the cross. We know that we partake of this in remembrance of that sacrifice. But this morning, as we partake of this, let's remember why that sacrifice was necessary. Let's let each one of us take a few moments and remember, as we pass this bread around, remember the sins that we have in our life, where we fall short individually. Because, as Paul said, that we all fall short of the glory of God. That we all have sin in our life. And it's because of the sin that's in my life, that's in your life, that this sacrifice was necessary. Because we have no other atonement for our sins except through this sacrifice. Christ also, you need to remember, that he also told us that, if we're not willing to forgive others, we tend to hold grudges. But if we're not willing to forgive others, then why should Christ forgive, or why should God forgive us? This whole sacrifice was meant for the forgiveness of our sins, so that, we should go to God for the forgiveness of our sins, but we should also forgive those who sinned against us. So let's think about those things as we pass this bread and this cup. See if you can thank you.
Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we ask that you bless this bread. Let us go on over our hearts and minds together as we examine ourselves and remember that great wonderful sacrifice Christ made for us. Jesus, the full man of Christ. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you, asking that you bless this, the fruit of the mouth that represents the still blood of Christ on that cross. As we remember that, it's one of the great wonderful sacrifices that we made. So thankfully, and knowing that he's going to the cross, let us examine ourselves and find ourselves worthy and try to, as Luke said a while ago, we all fall short. And that we shall come to the truth. Take this time to reflect upon our lives and what we can do to better serve you. It's in Jesus' most holy name we pray. Amen.
We're reminded of Jesus' words when he said, "As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. And yet a little while, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me because I live. You also will live." Great promises and confidence that we have in our Savior, the promises that he's given us from the Father. God sent his Son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river. I'll fight life's fight, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. We're reminded in Proverbs, Solomon said, "Do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day may bring." And James reminds us of this fact as well. He says, "Come now, you who say today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and make trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes." Words of this song remind us of the fact that we don't know about tomorrow. But we do have confidence in our Savior, who is in control of all things. If it's convenient for you, would you stand with me while we sing together? I don't know about tomorrow. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't worry o'er the future, for I know what Jesus said. And today I walk beside him, for he knows what is ahead. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know
know about tomorrow. It may bring me poverty, but the one who feeds the sparrow is the one who stands by me. And the path that be my portion may be through the flame or flood, but his presence goes before me, and I'm covered with his blood. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand.
Please be seated.
Song after Gary's lesson this morning is a song that reminds us tomorrow may be too late. Number 701 in the songbook.
Hello again. I always smile just a little bit because from time to time, and Steve will mention the title of my lesson, and then almost like a listen, don't worry, there's an actual lesson in there. I know the title says this, but it's going to be okay. And so I kind of felt like that with the Now I Lay Me Down to Sleep title that goes here. But we'll dig in and see if Steve's fears are justified or not. All right, so when I was growing up, Mama taught us to pray, and we always had the same one. We'd have the Bible lesson, and she was mean. She made us answer questions to see if we were actually paying attention. And then, and I love you, Mom, if you're listening to this later on. But, we would have the prayer when we got done, and basically it was just going through our family tree. It was, bless Mama, Daddy, and Sherry, Jolie, Gary, Craig. And I would throw my name out there, too, just because I want to make sure mine was okay. But we would go through the whole thing. I got really good at it. I mean, I could do it with my eyes closed. And but it was just one of the ways that she taught us how to pray. And, of course, there's other ones, that we learned. And we'll say traditional prayers. Not like the one like Lucas learned, the one that starts off with rub-a-dub-dub. There's one that's Now I Lay Me Down to Sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep, if I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. I always have to stop there at the end because I always want to say, feed Jake, he's been a good dog. But it's not that one, that's a totally different one. That's a song that's not in our songbook. The idea of teaching our kids to pray, and again, sometimes it's easier to do if they have the same thing so they can go, all right, here's kind of how we're going to get started and then what we kind of talk about and then here's how we end it. And that's something that God wants us to do as parents or even as grandparents or, if we're sitting in those classrooms there as Bible class teachers, being able to teach children to pray. Because if the children are praying, then eventually, hopefully, they'll grow up into adults that pray, and God wants to talk to us. And so he talks about it again over and over again, this idea of teaching our children. And Proverbs 22 and verse 6, train up a child in the way he should go, even when he is old, he will not depart from it. And again, not a recipe for make sure you cram a bunch of Bible into your child's head and he will never sin. Or he will never fall away. But it is, again, we've been through it. Again, even with things that are not Bible related. Even, things that we see that our parents do, and this is the way they did it. And even if we come up and say, okay, I'm never going to do that. I'm not going to be that type of parent. I'm not. And then all of a sudden we say something, I sound like my mother. Well, that's kind of the idea that God was hoping for, again, with this idea of continuing to teach. And again, prayer is one of those things. But even with the children of Israel, Deuteronomy chapter 4 and chapter 6, over and over again, he talks about this idea of, you know, make this known to your children. Make this known to your children's children. Set it in front of them. Hang it on the walls of your house. Talk about it as you're riding in your car. Okay, maybe you didn't say car. But as you're walking down and you're seeing different things, point out things to be able to tie that back into God and Bob. Remind them of where they came from. Remind them of where their family came from, the fact that God allowed them to escape slavery and be able to be free children there in the Promised Land. And we see, again, where this idea of teaching children bears fruit for the child, but also bears fruit for other people, because hopefully they also can grow up to be able to teach others. We see Paul talked about it with Timothy. I thank God whom I serve as did my ancestors with a clear conscience as I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you that I may be filled with joy. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. And so this generational faith is really, really important. It's really important. It is true Bible teaching, because we can have these generational ideas that grow and are hard to get rid of if they don't match up with the scriptures. But it is really important for us to be able to make sure that that is incorporated into our child's lives, our children's lives. But I wanted to take, again, that's kind of aside. What I wanted to do is be able to take this idea of this, again, we'll put that in quotes, traditional prayer. I don't know that it's one that is, you know, we need to be able to have a conversation with God, not to be able to recite poetry. And this idea of the now I lay me down to sleep, it's nice and rhymey, if that's a word. And to be able to have that, to be able to teach them something that they can say over and over again, I wanted to be able to, let's break it down and say, well, can, you know, is this, are the topics even biblical? You know, let's look at now I lay me down to sleep. I guess we don't have to worry, you know, we do sleep. So that's, we don't have to worry about that being biblical. We do sleep from time to time. But I pray the Lord my soul to keep. And, well, again, that concept is something that God wants us to think about. God wants to keep us. God wants us to want him to keep us. And we look at Numbers chapter 6. God is talking to Moses. He said, listen, all right, I need you to talk to Aaron. Aaron, of course, the high priest, and his sons, those priests. Here's what I want you to tell him to tell the children of Israel. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, so that they put my name upon the people of Israel, and I will bless them. Again, coming from God, I want to keep you. So offering a prayer that says, Lord, I want you to keep me. Well, that's a really good thought. And again, we could look at pretty much the entire book of Psalms. But we don't have time for all of that today. So I only picked one, but there are so many different verses that we could go to in the book of Psalms that talk about this idea of the Lord being there, being our protection, being our refuge, our place, our safe place that we can go, so that he can keep us protected from temptation, from the devil, from the world. And we look at Psalm 46 and verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. And again, this idea of being able to go to God, it's important for us to be able to go to him anytime, good times or bad. But again, that reminder that when things are going bad, and well, the people that we thought we could count on, even if they want to be there for us, sometimes they can't be. God is always going to be there for us. And so we look at Jesus, and in John chapter 10, he talked about this idea of keeping us At that time, the Feast of Dedication took place in Jerusalem. It was winter. Jesus was walking in the temple in the colonnade of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." Jesus answered them, "I told you, and you did not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name bear witness about me, but you do not believe because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch him out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one." There are so many things in this world that we cannot control. I would love to be able to hop in my car and go driving down the interstate and not have to worry about those other drivers. I'm looking at you, all right? Because I'm totally fine. But it's all those other drivers that are out there. I can't do anything about them. Sometimes, you know, they're drinking their Starbucks, putting on their makeup and talking on the phone. And I don't know how do they have all those hands to be able to do that? Oh, and I'm sorry, and hold the steering wheel. But there are things that in this world that, you know, we can't control that. But knowing that I don't have to worry about somebody, again, one of those other people, or even the devil, being able to come out there and say, "You know, I know Gary really wants to go to heaven, but I'm going to make it so that he can't." Nobody can say that. And again, that's our ultimate goal. We mentioned Matthew 6:33 and seeking first the kingdom of God. That was in this morning's Bible class. I can seek the kingdom of God first and actually go. I can actually, again, be a part of the church and then be a part of that church being presented to God on the day of judgment. Because God said he was going to protect me. He was going to keep me. Yes, I can choose to leave him. But I am not going to be shanghaied, kidnapped, dragged off, hauled away from heaven against my will. Paul told the church in Thessalonica, "But the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one." So this idea again of Lord, keep my soul. What a great thought that we can pray for and know that we can have. And then there's the next part of that. If I should die before I wake, I pray my soul the Lord to take. I'll just give you a minute to, again, run that through. Is that even scriptural? Well, according to Luke chapter 16, yes. And in Luke chapter 16, we see the story of the rich man and Lazarus. And, of course, you have the rich man. He was living the good life. He had everything that he wanted and ate great food. And then you have Lazarus, who was outside. He was poor, had absolutely nothing. And the dogs came up and licked his sores. He wanted the crumbs that were falling off the rich man's table, just something to be able to have. And then verse number 22, the poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. And then we compare that to what happened to the rich man. The rich man also died and was buried, and in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham and saw Lazarus. So this idea of taking our soul, that's exactly what happened with Lazarus. When he died, he was taken to paradise. Well, that's what I want. Again, it's not that, we don't know what it's like to die. As far as I know, nobody's been through that here yet. And so there is that angst, nervousness I don't know what it's like. But to know that the Lord talked about it, and listen, when my children die, when you are mine, there's going to be somebody there to escort you to where you're going to next. Well, that's peaceful. That's reassuring. And so, yes, I would love to be able to pray that to God and know that that can actually happen. And the really important part for us to remember is we don't know when that's going to happen. I mean, you know, we've got great plans for what is what we want to do. I mean, we even have these things called calendars. They used to be made of paper. Okay. But we have them on our phone, we have books, we have all these different things. Here's what's coming up. And then we get reminded of how fast life is. James chapter 4 and verse 13. Come now, you who say today or tomorrow, we will go into such and such a town, spend a year there, trade, make a profit, yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. Again, you've got, there's descriptions of, we have the mist, this cloud, or something. I don't know if y'all noticed, it was a little cold this morning. So you can blow that the smoke out of your mouth or the mist, and it just goes away. We have descriptions of our life being like a flower that blooms and grows. Well, you know, flowers, they eventually die. And that's the description that we've been given over and over again, that we're only here for just a little while. Are we ready for the when our life is over? Luke chapter 12, again, this idea of making plans. Jesus talked about the stories of somebody who, they had great plans. I've got all this stuff. I need to build bigger barns. I need to a place to hold all my stuff. Tomorrow I'm going to set out. I'm going to build a bigger building. Verse number 20 of Luke 12. But God said to him, "Fool, this night your soul is required of you. The things you have prepared, whose will they be? So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God." What are your plans for tomorrow? Most of us have plans to live. I mean, there's some other things. But most of us have plans to live tomorrow. What if that isn't reality? In John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." If our hope is, I want the Lord to take my soul, I would like the escort to paradise, well, there's a way that happens. And Jesus said, He is that way. So are we singing loud and proud in our best Sinatra voice that I did it my way? Or are we humbly coming before God and saying, I did it thy way? Because, well, it matters if we're looking at where we want to go for all eternity. So I don't want to mess it up for you, but there's this movie called Return of the Jedi, and this little green alien, his name's Yoda. And he dies. I don't want to mess it up for anybody. All right, but he talks about being 900 years old to this other guy, Luke Skywalker. Maybe you've heard of him. And I'm not going to use the Yoda voice. I think Jeremy probably does a better Yoda voice than I do. But again, he tells Luke, he said, "Listen, when you're 900 years old, you're not going to look this good," in again his way. And well, he was mostly right. If we're completely talking about how our bodies are going to look, that when we reach 900 years old, we're not going to look as good as a green hairy alien, because we'll probably just be dust if there's any of that left. But again, we know there's more to the story than just how good our bodies are going to look at 900 years old, you know, when we reach 900 years. You know, that another song pops in my head. It's got like a jukebox or something going on. But 'tis a sweet and glorious thought that comes to me. I'll live on. Yes, I'll live on. Again, when we are born, well, that starts our life. And even after we die, we'll live on. Are we ready for that? Because that's what we're striving for. That's why we're living our life. There's some other things that we get to do along the way. But we are living our life to be ready for when we die. And we look at Revelation chapter 20. I'm sorry. No, really. We're gonna look at Revelation chapter 20. We'll look at Revelation chapter 20. And again, this is a choice we get to make. There is an alternative to being escorted to paradise. It's called torment. And it is a choice. It's just not a good one. And I saw a great white throne, and him who was seated on it. For him, his presence, earth and sky fled away. No place was found for them. I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books, according to what they had done. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one of them, according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. Which sounds a lot worse than paradise. But we can choose to go to either place. So I tweaked the last couple of points here to tweak the last line. And again, looking at things that if this is offered as a kind of prayer, again, it's more of a poem than a prayer. But again, if I should wake before I die, I pray my soul, the Lord, to purify. Again, when we talk about this first version, it's, okay, listen, what happens if I'm asleep and then I die? What happens? And, you know, this is what I need the Lord to do for me. What if we wake up the next day? What then? And so, again, that's what I want to look at here. Again, I pray my soul, the Lord, to purify. This is, again, another thought, another prayer that we should be praying. Because, again, what's the one thing that can keep us out of paradise? What's the one thing that's going to keep us out of heaven? Sin. Who's the only one that can get rid of that? The Lord. Acts 22:16, again, Paul, when he was telling about, when he was obeying the gospel, he was in, you know, so what, he was told, you know, why are you waiting? Get up. Rise, be baptized, wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. We need to make sure, again, if we are choosing, hey, I want to go to heaven for all eternity, we need to make sure that we too are purified, our souls are clean, our sin is gone. And of course, that continues, we see in 1 John 1:7. If we continue to walk in the light, if we continue to, again, to make that choice, I'm going to do whatever it takes to get to heaven. Well, that means walking in the light. That means following the example of Jesus that he's laid out there for us. And again, being completely obedient to God. Then his blood will continue to cleanse our sins. We have a part to play. It's not just making the decision, hey, I want to do that, and then just kind of waiting around and letting God show up. We look at Peter's letter to us in 2 Peter chapter 1, there are some things, again, these choices that we're making, they are changes. It's not just what's in it for me. It's how does God want me to be? For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith. Okay, yes, believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Great. Now do more. Do something with that knowledge that you know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. There are some things that you need to do to your life, to you, to be pleasing to God. So this idea of supplementing your faith. When we understand what a supplement is, right? We got stores that sell supplements. These are the things that you can add to your diet to make you healthy. Well, these are the things you can add to your faith to make your soul healthy. Add virtue. And virtue with knowledge. And knowledge with self-control. And self-control with steadfastness. And steadfastness with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love. And then verse number 8. This is a little word. He just puts four in there. The F-O-R, not the F-O-U-R. I wonder what it's there for. So he is pointing back to everything that he just said. All of these things that you're going to supplement. All these things that you're going to add. If you do those things, if these qualities are yours and are increasing, again, it's not just, okay, I showed a little godliness today. I think I'm good, right? We only have to do that once, and then we can move on. I showed a little virtue, brotherly affection. I showed somebody some love. No. He says if they are yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For whoever lacks these qualities is so nearsighted that he is blind, having forgotten that he was cleansed from his former sins. Therefore, brothers, be all the more diligent to confirm your calling and election. For if you practice these qualities, you will never fall. For in this way there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Yes, praying for the Lord to purify our souls is a great prayer to pray. What are we going to do with it? Because again, if we are looking at this as, okay, I didn't die while I'm asleep, and so if I should wake before I die, I pray my soul the Lord to use. I ran out of rhyming words. I'm sorry. But Lord, use me. Again, we have a purpose here. One of the things that we've been given, this great commission that we've been given, is to go into all the world and preach the gospel. This is teach others. Again, helping them obey the gospel. And then, well, there's more. Again, we look at the work of the church as described in the New Testament. Again, there's benevolence, there's evangelism, there's edification. It's going to be grouped into those three things. Here is what we are supposed to be doing. Again, the church, that's, if you look around the room, that's who you're looking at. We have things to do. Do we pray to God that he is able to use us? And then do we make ourselves available to be used? In Acts chapter 10, again, we see Peter describing the perfect example. Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him." Again, this is the first time the Gentiles had been able to obey the gospel and become Christians. "As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good. He the great example is and pattern for me. Where he leads, I'll follow. Are we going about doing good? Because that's exactly what the Son of God did. The one that we're named after, Christ, as we are called Christians. We look at Titus chapter 2, and Paul telling Titus, show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. And in your teaching, show integrity, dignity, and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. Again, how horrible is it when, I just can't believe it's them again. Oh, they're always about doing good. Thanks. And there's some people who would say it just like that. But again, that's just somebody that's looking for something bad and can't really find anything, so they take the good thing and make it sound bad. Because how many times did they say that about Jesus? Oh, there he goes again, raising the dead. That blind guy can see now, thanks to him. Oh, they really didn't like him. And all he was going about was doing good. What a horrible thing to say about those that are following after him and living, trying to live just like he lived. Again, Titus chapter 3, this idea of being devoted. This saying is trustworthy, and I want you to insist on these things so that those who have believed in God may be careful to devote themselves to good works. These things are excellent and profitable for people. Are we devoted? Because he says in verse number 14, it's if we are devoted to good works, well, that keeps us from being unfruitful. And we know what happens to those unfruitful branches. Well, they get cut off and burned in the fire. Again, is that what we're asking for God to do with us, use us? And then are we making ourselves available? And it doesn't have to be anything that's completely outrageous. And, we don't have to have a 37-step plan to be able to do good works. We look at Mark chapter 9 again, and this idea, Jesus said, whoever's not against us is with us. Whoever gives a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ will by no means lose his reward. It's as simple as sometimes it's being nice. And sometimes something as simple as, well, they look thirsty, let me help them out here. How about some water? Because the world is, I'm worried about me, I'm worried about what's going on with me, I'm focused on me, and I really can't even stop long enough to give somebody a cup of water. Because I'm not going to get done what I need to get done. And Jesus' focus, he had a mission to do. He had a purpose. He was here to, seek and save the lost, save the world. But he stopped. Talked to people. Healed people. Fed people. Because they needed it. Do we have that kind of heart? Because we look at, again, Hebrews chapter 12. He's our perfect example. And, boy, what a reward he got for all the good work he did. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not resisted to the point of shedding your blood. Look at what doing good did for Jesus. It got him on the cross. Which, again, that was according to God's plan. But he knew how the people would react. Here was the perfect person. Here was the person with the most heart anybody could ever have. He was beaten and tortured and hung up on a cross to die for hours before he finally died. And he knew that was going to be the result. And he did everything exactly the way God wanted him to do it anyway. Showing his heart. Helping people. Ultimately, giving his life helping people. So as we end today, I give you some homework. I'll give you a couple of questions. Again, thinking of, again, this idea of if I should die before I wake, or if I should wake before I die. What if you lay your head down tonight and, well, it you don't pick it back up tomorrow morning? If you die before tomorrow morning, how are you going to spend eternity? See, I can't answer that question. Nobody in here can answer it for each other. Nobody knows everything that's going on. God can. And the Bible tells us that we can. We can know whether we're saved or not. So answer that question. And I think that's a good question to keep in our heads often. I think that's a great question to ask before we go to sleep, and if the answer is not good, I know I've said this before, but I mean this in the nicest way. I hope you have a hard time sleeping. Not that I want you to be tired. I want you to do something about it. Where are you going to spend eternity? Because it's really hard to do things while you're sleeping. Like asking for forgiveness. We need to do it while we're awake. It's hard to obey the gospel while we're sleeping. We need to do that while we're awake. Where we're spending eternity is totally worth it. But also, again, the other side. If you wake up tomorrow morning, how are you going to spend the rest of your life? If I should wake before I die, what are we asking God there? Purify my soul? We have a part to play in that as well. Use me for your good works? We definitely have a part to play in that as well. Because it's what we do in our waking hours that determines where we spend eternity. That can help answer the question that's up at the very top. And my encouragement is, don't wait too long to answer these questions and to think about it. Tomorrow may be too late. And amazingly enough, it just happens to be the title of the song that we're about to sing. To, again, hopefully think ourselves as we are answering these questions for ourselves, I need to make sure that I'm ready because tomorrow may be too late. I know little orphan Annie said it's only a day away. What if we don't have that day? What if this is it? I mean, I'm talking about tomorrow. We may not even have the next 5 minutes. Let this song encourage us, ourselves, to make sure that we understand eternity is at risk. But also, this is us singing to each other, hey, remember, today is the day of salvation. Tomorrow may be too late. If there's something that we can do to encourage you to make the right decision, to move toward God for the first time, or to move back to Him again, we'd love to be able to do that, even now as we stand and sing.
Today is the day of salvation. Tomorrow may be too late. There's danger and death in delaying. Accept God's saving grace. His life on the cross He has given. Oh, come while yet you may. He's earnestly pleading. Oh, make no delay. Tomorrow may be too late. Today is the day of salvation. Tomorrow may be too late. The judgment day, brother, is coming. Prepare ye for that day. His pardon and mercy He offers. Obey while yet you may. He'll save you from sin and bring sweet peace within. tomorrow may be too late. Today is the day of salvation, tomorrow may be too late. A home up in heaven is waiting, oh, make the start today. Repent and confess and be baptized, there is no other way. Give Jesus your life and thus walk in his way. Tomorrow may be too late.
Thank you, Gary. I knew you wouldn't disappoint us. I do have the privilege of being able to have a little bit of insight into what he's going to be talking about, so I knew it was going to be good. Thank you, all of you, for being here this morning, and I hope that the message presented will give you some thought, some things to think about concerning the life that we live in service to God. In Psalm 37, a Psalm of David, he said, "Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will act. He will bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday." While we're living in this life, we encourage one another to trust the Lord and to obey the Lord, because he'll be our Lord now and forever. We'll sing the first stanza of this song, and then Jeremiah is going to lead us in our closing prayer. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you now, thanking you for all the many blessings that you have given us. Thank you for this time that we've had to come together to worship you and learn more about you, Lord. We ask that you be with us throughout the rest of this week. Help us come back in the next point of time and help us to always remember to keep you first and remember the sacrifice that your son made to come down on this earth, to walk with us and attempt it, and to still go without sinning and make the sacrifice that he made for us. We ask that you be with those on the prayer list and help them with whatever their needs may be for you.